I'm going to start. I have started recording of the session, and this session will be shared with you all. So I hope that no one has any problem with this. So this is just for your consent, guys, right? So okay, guys, let us start today's session. So today we are going to discuss very important topic, which is usually discussed. This is the like very basic question from every interviewer about, can you please explain how does your application flow work? Or how does traffic flow in your organization? Which means someone can tell you a question in a different format as well, that can you please explain about your infrastructure architecture? So infrastructure architecture. So is there anyone who can tell me something about this? Like how do we explain infrastructure architecture? Yes guys, anyone?
Can I tell?
Yeah, sure. Anyone?
In my organization, developer write the code, and as soon as developer commit the code in SCM, I have integrated the SCM with the Jenkins.
Okay.
And there, and build server is also integrated with Jenkins, where build happens. And after build happens, I have integrated Ansible server with Jenkins server. That Ansible server copy the build to the deployment server, where many deployment server means testing for deployment for testing, where various testing is done. And if everything is okay, then we deploy the build to deployment server, production server.
Okay, good. Up to some extent, it is really nice. Good to hear that.
And once it is live on production, we have a server that is for monitoring the application.
Nice. Anything else?
No.
Great, Manish. Good to know. Okay, so okay. Let us go to Ankita. Ankita, can you please explain the same thing, or if you have some different views on it?
No, sir. It's for mine also. It's like similar. So, like for me, I have an example. I have experience of deploying a Java application. So it will first fetch the code from the Git or any SCM tool. Then it will build the artifact using Maven, and after we got the artifact, we can keep it in artifact repository like Nexus or something. And then with the help of Docker, we can build a Docker file. Like Docker image using the Docker file, and then we can deploy it in the Kubernetes. And all these steps we can integrate in Jenkins. Like for each step, we can write a separate stage step so that all the steps we can integrate in Jenkins.
Great, good to know that. Okay, so the particular thing which you are explaining here is you are talking only about the deployment, like deployment structure, like how do you deploy the things. But let us say, if someone is going to ask that particular thing, like how does infrastructure work in your organization, right? So you should have the understanding from backend perspective as well as from a particular user and user's perspective. So for example, there is a particular domain. For example, let us define it like servergyan.com, right? There is a domain name known as servergyan.com. So if someone is going to type in this domain into a browser, right guys? So how would you ensure, or how will you explain this particular thing, that after typing in this domain into a browser, this is accessible? What all happens in background?
Yeah, so the request first will go to the Route 53 on the DNS server. There it will get resolved to its IP. By IP, I mean the IP of the Elastic Load Balancer.
Mm-hmm.
Then it will go to the web servers. From there, it will have another load balancer, which will flow the traffic to the respective application server, which will communicate with the database server after then. And then the the user will get his request response from the application. There will be like auto scaling group here also, with the elastic load balance and target group.
Okay, so I guess that you are not going to take a month even to get a new job.
Sorry?
You will not take even a month to get a new job. You are almost ready for your new job. I must appreciate that. You have explained really well.
Thank you.
It means you have gone through the stuff, right? Okay.
Sorry, mute. Yes. Yeah.
You are doing well. Great. Good to know. Okay. So let me tell you what happens here is, guys. So for example, this is very first time that I have hosted this domain, servergun.com. No one knows about it, right? So as soon as I will type in this particular URL into a browser, and that browser will definitely belong to my laptop only, right? Laptop, mobile, desktop, whatever device you want to call. So you can consider that device to be. So first of all, as soon as I will type in here, so this particular browser belongs to my system. Let us say this is my laptop. Let me figure out. Okay, so this is my laptop, right? So with every single laptop, there are a couple of components which are associated with it. First of all, there is one IP address, right? Then after gateway, network mask, then after gateway, then after DNS, right, guys? So as Ankita explained, so obviously things are same. I am in agreement with her that things are going to work in the same way. But what happens, let us deep dive a little more. First of all, when we have a laptop, and this laptop has a couple of components which are known as, first of all, IP address. There will be a particular network mask for that particular laptop, right? The particular IP address, whatever is assigned to this laptop. So that will have some network mask. There will be a gateway. Now, gateway can be either public or either private IP address. We need not to worry about. So that is handled by your local IT team. But in most of cases, this remains a private IP address from the same series from where like you have associated one IP address. So this is known as gateway. And finally, the DNS. Now, what is use of DNS? So as most of us have mobile phone with us, whenever some new person meet and we exchange our contact numbers, so we do not prefer to save the contact number by its own number. What do? We convert that particular number, or you can call that, rather than converting, we bind that number with a name. Right, guys? We prefer to bind that contact number with a name, because being human, we prefer to remember names very easily rather than the numbers. Wherein like computer prefers to work on numbers, computer works on binary format only, right? So whenever we type in a domain name into browser, and guys, just a moment. Yes, guys. So what happens here is, so this particular domain name request will be resolved by this DNS. Now, what is this DNS? So guys, first of all, we need to deep dive a little more into DNS section. So there are different type of DNS. You can make a note out of it that how does DNS work? Guys, please ensure to make a note out of it, because someone can ask that after what happens when we type in a domain name into a browser. See, question going to remain same. We are going to discuss about infrastructure only, but there might be some different way to asking questions, right, guys? So first of all, this is known as local DNS. Now, what is local DNS? the particular DNS which is configured within organization, and like that is working as a like local DNS server. You can call that caching only DNS server as well. So this is our local DNS server which we usually configure within our etc like resolve.conf file in Linux, and there are different places in Windows operating system, right? So these are known as local DNS server. So as we know, like local DNS server is not authorized to have the entry of all the domain names, right? So now request will go to ISP. Whenever we have an internet connection, so at that moment the particular ISP provides couple of things, such as couple of configuration item ISP provides, such as IP address, gateway, netmask, and one DNS IP address, one or two, depends on the DNS availability with the ISP. So this ISP DNS will be responsible to resolve the queries. Let us say if our local DNS server is not able to resolve anything, then local DNS server will start looking for the entries against this particular domain name to ISP DNS. Guys, please feel free to ask any question anytime. Any question so far, guys?
Yeah, I have a question. So what exactly host file is working? Like what exactly host? Under etc, we have a host file, right?
Yes, we have etc host file. Okay. So etc host file works like a local DNS for us. That is not DNS, but let us say that I want to test some domain name. For example, I have hosted a website, but still that is not pointed to any DNS server. But I would like to access that domain name with any, I would like to access that IP address against any domain name, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, what is going to happen? I can define any domain name, let us say sterling.com. Right? Okay. Or I have mapped that IP address against it. So in that case, it is going to work. So first of all, when we enter a domain name into browser, first of all, it checks our local file, which is etc host. So if any entry is found against that, so obviously it will not go to DNS. It will start looking out for that file only. It will start resolving that domain name against that IP address.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, so then ISP DNS comes into picture. If local DNS does not have entry, does not have information, then obviously it will forward the request to local ISP, ISP DNS server. If ISP does not have information, so even ISPs are interconnected, right? So near ISP, so even ISP, near ISP DNS, it will go to there, because obviously one ISP might reach out to another. So this is how it is going to work. If that also does not have information, so even either this DNS or either near ISP DNS can reach out to maybe Google DNS, right guys? If even Google does not have information about it, and why I'm saying that even Google does not have information about it, because I have just hosted this domain name. This domain name was never accessed before, right guys? So in order to ensure this particular thing, that we are going to host this particular IP address. So I am going to check with Google DNS. If it does not have, so Google DNS knows very well that what is the domain name. Like this is known as TLD, top level domain. So guys, what is the top level domain here? .com, right? So there are approx 13 top level domain like .com, .edu, .org and others, right? .net, .gov. So there are 13 top level domains. If I talk about today, so definitely guys, number of top domains are increasing, like .io, .to, right? So these sort of top level domains are increasing. So that's a different thing, but concept is going to remain same, right? So either it is .com or either it is .io. So that's a different thing here. Okay. So now when we talk about Google does not have information about this particular domain name, which is servergan.com. So what is going to happen here? Google DNS will start looking out for the top level DNS, like that is known as root DNS. Now guys, what is root DNS? So root DNS is that server. Guys, when we purchase a domain name, so obviously let us say there is a particular domain name known as google.com. So guys, is there any possibility that I can purchase a domain name known as google.com?
No, because it's already there.
It's already available. There might be like million of websites which are not live, but someone or the other has already purchased that domain. Right?
Yes.
There are million of websites which are already booked by people. Might be they might have some plan to resell it, or might be they might have a plan to like host that website later on. But yes, there are good enough chances that the domain is already sold. So how does the domain seller, let us say it is GoDaddy, Namecheap.com, Name.com, or maybe any other, how do these domains provider get to know that this is sold or not? So guys, these domain registrars, we call them domain registrars. These domain registrars like queries to these root DNS servers. These root DNS servers knows very well whether the like domain is available or not. If it is available, they will show like domain is available. If it is not, they will ensure that domain is already purchased. Domain is already sold. Domain not available. Any sort of message they would print on your screen. So guys, if it is sold, definitely like server again belongs to me now. So root DNS server, like .com root DNS server already knows that this particular domain was sold out from GoDaddy, because I know that I purchased serverGain.com from GoDaddy. So what will it do? It will forward the request to GoDaddy.com, because GoDaddy is my domain registrar. GoDaddy is responsible to let us know that where the domain is hosted. Request will be forwarded to GoDaddy. Now within GoDaddy account, I will get to know that where my actual servers are pointing, right? So from GoDaddy, request will be sent to domain registrar. So domain registrar will be responsible to let me know that where the particular either DNS is running or the particular domain IP address it will provide me. This is how it works. So let us say that I purchased a domain from GoDaddy and finally I have hosted my domain on let us say AWS, Route 53. Right, guys? So how does request flow? First of all, it will go to local DNS server, which is available within my own laptop. Then after, it will go to my ISP, then after near ISP. But it can be possible that near ISP might not come into picture. Let me tell you, near ISP might not come into picture. My ISP directly can query to google.com or Google DNS about the IP address which are associated with this domain name. If Google does not have, it will go to root DNS, then after to domain registrar, and domain registrar being responsible to resolve my queries, then it will inform me that where the domain name of this particular website are hosted. Right, guys? Now, it's your time to ask any question if you have. Yes, guys, any query? Manish, Manoj?
No, I got it.
Ankita, any question?
No.
Okay, great. Good to know. Fine, guys. So I'm going to remove this particular section from here, because right now we are clear that how does DNS work? Okay. So what is the protocol which DNS works on? TCP or UDP?
AWS provides application wise and the network wise.
Manoj, I'm sorry to say, buddy, but your voice is actually not clear. Can you please come again? Can you please repeat your words? Still in.
I believe it's TCP IP.
Okay. Ankita?
Oh, no idea, sir.
Pardon?
No idea, sir. But since TCP works on network level, it might use TCP.
Okay. Manish?
No idea about it.
Okay. then we all are discussing at right path. Because see, the particular things, let us say you have explained each and everything about it, but when it comes to troubleshooting, then you must be knowing the background of these protocols. So guys, just let me clear that DNS works on both protocols. DNS can support TCP as well as UDP, but primary preference of DNS protocol is UDP. DNS works on UDP protocol. UDP means what is the meaning of UDP, Ankita? Stalin, what is the meaning of UDP?
Unified.
Manish?
I don't remember this time.
Buddy, these are basic things, right? And sometime when we are preparing for interview, so we do not focus on very basic things. Just see that we are facing an interview and someone is going to ask, okay, what is UDP? And we do not know. So that's not good. So use a datagram protocol, I guess, right? And what is TCP, Ankita?
Transmission protocol.
Yes, perfect. Perfectly fine. So that is transmission control protocol and user datagram protocol. That's it. Okay. So fine. So I'm going to remove this particular section. Now I hope that we are clear with DNS work flow. Okay. So now when I type in a particular domain name into a browser, like this laptop has a browser and I have entered in a domain name here. So first of all, now let's draw a particular proper diagram, which we are here for today, because we need to understand like working functionality of an application like thoroughly. Right, guys? So first of all, there will be a domain, there will be a component known as DNS. Now we know the DNS works on port number 53 and the data flows preference are with UDP, right? So as soon as I will type in a domain name into browser, then request will be forwarded to DNS. What DNS? We need not to worry about now, because now we have understood the concept of it. Now DNS will be responsible to resolve the query. And where will it send? So let us say, let us assume that we have a static website. Let us not make it complicated first. So let us have one static website that does not have any database. That is very simple website. And we have, let us say this is an EC2 machine. And I have hosted only one index.html page here, which says hello world, nothing else, right? So DNS will resolve this particular website against this EC2 machine, and that is it. This is how website is resolved, right? This is one EC2 machine. It has one public IP address. This IP address is mapped against this particular domain name under this DNS. So Ankita, initially you said that request will be forwarded to Route 53. So dear, Route 53 is only related to AWS. If you are talking about AWS infrastructure, then your statement is right. Otherwise, a person might ask you that, what if I'm not using AWS then? So we need to be strict to our answer, that request will be forwarded to DNS. Now that may be depending on the DNS service provider. It could be GoDaddy, it could be Namecheap.com, it could be name.com, it could be Google, it could be AWS, Azure. So everyone provides its own DNS service, right? Okay. The very next thing which we have to discuss here is, let us say that we are not using this much simple infrastructure diagram we do not have. So we are using some different type of infrastructure where we need to ensure like high availability, scalability, like elasticity we are talking about. So now, first of all, we have a DNS here, and this DNS is mapped against a load balancer, like ELB, Elastic Load Balancer. right? So furthermore, we are going to discuss within the coming classes, we are going to discuss that what type of load network, what type of load balancer we are using here, how we are ensuring SSL termination here, and these sort of things we are going to discuss like after some time. But for now, let us have a broad picture. Because if you start explaining everything in detail, then interviewer will start digging, like deep diving into that particular topic. So first of all, let us have a 10,000 feet overview. Then if a person is like more interested, then person would definitely ask you further questions on the top of it. But at first glance, we guys need to let them know the basic flow. For example, that we can say that we have like when we type in the particular domain name into browser, then request will be forwarded to DNS. Then in order to ensure high availability, we are using load balancer here. Rather than saying like application load balancer or network load balancer, we will be focusing on that we have a load balancer here. Which load balancer? So we already know we have three type of load balancer, which are, what are the type of load balancer guys do we have?
Application, network, and classic.
Application, network, and classic, and IP or gateway. As of today in AWS, we have four type of load balancers: application load balancer, network, classic, and IP or gateway load balancer we have. This is new type of load balancer which we have, and that is available in couple of regions only, and that is being expanding day by day. So might be possible within a couple of months that will be available in all the regions, right guys? But yes, if you say only about these three, then that is good. That will be more than good enough, right? We shall be discussing about that. Why do we use application load balancer, network, and classic load balancer? What are the use cases? We will discuss later on. But for now, let's focus on load balancer only. Okay, so guys, now we have load balancer. Behind load balancer, we have target groups. This is known as target group. So guys, within target group, we have multiple EC2 machine. We might have multiple EC2 machines. Now this load balancer is going to distribute load among these machines. The instances which we have, this load balancer will be responsible to forward request here. Based on the requirement, there will be a component which is known as auto scaling group. So this is auto scaling group. This auto scaling group will handle the particular traffic which is coming to this particular server. Load balancer is directly not associated with this, but the particular target group is associated with this auto scaling group, right? So we can define some rules here. Let us say based on like load average on these servers, based on the like response time of these instances, this auto scaling group will keep on adding or removing servers from this target group. So this load balancer will send the traffic to all available instances within this target group. Right, guys? Any questions so far?
Still, I'm a bit confused. So it's go to ELB. From ELB, it is going to ask for the auto scaling group, and then auto scaling is going to check whether which EC2 instance is free.
And Wait. Okay, Stalin. So let us say that we do not have any auto scaling group in picture for now.
Okay.
So let us say we have 3 + 3 + 3, like total 9 servers we have in this target group.
Mm-hmm.
In peak hours, these 9 servers are utilized properly. Let us say my peak hours is maybe 9 to 6. Let us assume. So between 9 to 6, I'm utilizing my resource fully.
Okay.
But 9 to 6 are my peak hours. But let us say after 9 p.m. in the evening till 9 a.m. in the evening, I have only 5% traffic over these instances.
Okay.
So what would happen in that case? So I shall be like, I might be able to serve the traffic from two instances only, wherein I am paying to AWS or to my CSP like cloud service provider for 9 instances.
Yes.
So why do I need to pay that much? There should be some mechanism which will monitor my traffic frequency or traffic availability within this particular target group. So what is target group? A set of servers which are serving the same request. That is known as target group, okay. Right?
Yeah.
So what happens here is, so what do we do? We have these servers available. So in peak hours, there has to be a mechanism which will ensure that, let us say, if there is high amount, high volume of traffic, then number of servers should be increased. And if the traffic is not up to the mark, that is less. So like these servers should be removed. Only these three servers are good enough for me to serve the traffic in night. But let us say as soon as it is 9 a.m. in the morning, so it should add three more servers. And let us say today there is no, there is not a lot of traffic. Let us say it is weekend, and on weekends, like a lot of users do not come to my server, my infrastructure or my website. So I will have only six servers for daytime. But if due to any reason, let us say it is a special day, like Christmas is arriving, right? So if that is the case, what will I do here? I will have nine servers, but these are static. I will have to perform these servers manually. I will have to increase number of servers manually here, right?
Yeah.
So there has to be a mechanism. There has to be a way using which we can ask some other service to manage my these instances. So I will have auto scaling.
Got it.
So auto scaling is not doing anything. That is a software configuration which is regularly monitoring this service.
Mm-hmm.
So when we will create a load balancer,
target groups, correct?
Pardon?
Monitoring to target groups, correct?
Yes. So rather than calling the, like you're talking about monitoring, so it is ensuring the particular availability of instances based on the rules which we are going to set within this auto scaling group. For example, by default, the response time of these servers, like out of these nine servers, each server is responding within 500 milliseconds whenever any request is forwarded from this load balancer to this target group. So average response time of these servers are under 500 milliseconds. Okay. But due to access request, now the response time has been increased to maybe 600 milliseconds, maybe to 1 second, right?
Okay.
So based on my rule set, so what will I do here is, we will discuss this in detail when we will go to AWS section, like within this particular batch. So what is going to happen? We are going to ensure that auto scaling group will automatically add other servers as well within this target group. Why it is so? Because when these nine servers are not good enough to serve the number of requests which are coming, so this particular auto scaling group will add like maybe one, two or three more servers based on the requirement.
Okay.
So we can have multiple rules based on the latency, based on the like response time, based on load average, based on network utilization, based on disk utilization, based on like network bytes in, network bytes out, based on like disk IO performance. So we can have multiple rule set within auto scaling group based on which like whatever its stats are generated from these individual EC2 instances that will be reported to auto scaling group. Auto scaling group has sort of admin access onto this target group. Let us say, when I say that if response time is greater than 500 milliseconds, add new servers. But I have set another rules that if response time is below 500 milliseconds, remove these three servers.
Got it.
So I shall not be worrying about it.
Mm-hmm.
As and when required, my auto scaling group will keep on adding or terminating servers from my target group. That is how it works. Now, there can be a question in mind that how will you ensure that the new servers which are adding here, which are being created, so these have latest code available. There can be a question that how would you ensure that whenever new server is added to it or all like it has the same code or same software or same files available which are available in remaining servers. So guys, what do we do here is we have a particular mechanism, which a particular component, which is known as AMI, like Amazon Machine Image. Whenever we do deployment, we take one image out of this. Let us say I have deployed a software onto these servers, these EC2 machines, which are currently running. After every deployment, I will create one AMI out of this. I will create one AMI out of this, right? Out of these, any of these instance. Then after, I will update that AMI to my auto scaling group, that whenever you are going to create a new resource, a new server, then use this AMI. So post every deployment, this AMI should be updated. So whenever we are doing deployment, that should be in our that particular deployment file, that after doing deployment, we need to create one image out of any of these instances. And after that, image has to be updated within auto scaling group. So as and when new server will be created, that will be having the same code, which is already available within these servers, right guys? Any questions so far?
No questions, got it.
Ankita, any question? Manoj, Manish?
No.
Okay, so now when we have discussed about this particular component like auto scaling group, why do we use it? How does it work? And furthermore, we are going to deep dive into auto scaling group as well, load balancer, target group. So guys, now let us talk about one more component. This particular target group is related to web servers. Right, guys? So right now, we are talking about this particular component, which is web servers. So after web server, we have a particular component, which is known as app servers. So this particular component is related to application server. So once again, we will have to ensure that all the servers which are running here, they should also have like some traffic being served from these servers, right? So once again, guys, what we have to do here is whenever a request will come to these servers, these have to forward request to these servers. But how we are going to handle that? Because obviously we cannot have one-to-one mapping of these servers under these servers, right? Like we have 9 servers in web. So we might have 15 servers in app, or we might have only 5 servers, right? It could be possible that based on the particular application or the particular programming language which we have selected. So based on that, the response time of these servers could be less or could be higher. Right, guys? So how do we need to ensure that the particular requests which are coming onto these individual EC2 machines that is forwarded to all these instances? How will you ensure it? Just tell him.
No idea.
Ankita, you definitely have an idea.
Yes, sir. So we will have another load balancer here.
Perfect. I knew it that you have an idea. See how intelligent I am that I have an idea. Isn't it? You have studied really well, Ankita. I'm really pleased to see that you are really hardworking. Okay, not a problem. So guys, whenever we are going to ask the server to forward request, so see the particular picture in between. So there will be a load balancer in between. How it is going to work, let me tell you. Like this, it is going to work and we will have a load balancer in between. These web servers are going to forward request to this load balancer. Now further, this load balancer is going to distribute traffic among these servers. Right, guys? Now, let us talk about what type of load balancer we are using here. So guys, we are going to have app ELB. Like we are going to have application load balancer here for web servers. And why it is so? So guys, there might be a question that what is difference between application load balancer and network load balancer? Any idea about it?
In application load balancer, it sends the traffic, and according to the traffic, it forward the traffic to the group of server. there can be route based traffic or there can be host based traffic like that in application load balancer, but network load balancer I don't have any idea.
Okay, Manoj.
Application load balancer works on like HTTPS and HTTP. Okay. And then network load balancer works on UDP and TCP. So to target group web server, to target group app server, so we need to use network load balancer. So it works on a low, like a network load balancer works on a layer 4. So that has more enhancement in the routing policy.
Okay, great. So now tell me, what are all layers? As network load balancer works on layer 4, right? What all layers are there?
Like I have read about like layer 7 and layer 4 about these load balancers.
But that is fine. Layers, but as you are talking about layers, so yeah, what all layers are there?
No idea on that.
Okay. Stellan.
I believe like application, physical, then session, transport, presentation, and network layer. All people seem to be need data process, I believe.
So though these are very, very basic things, we are actually not supposed to discuss these. But see, as I'm asking, so any person, let us say, a person tries to know during interview that how depth knowledge of concepts do you have? That goes like A, P, S, T, N, D, P. A for Apple.
Application.
A for Apple. P for?
Presentation.
Excuse me for my spellings because I'm really poor with English.
Session.
I'll figure it out. Okay, what P for?
Transport.
N for?
Network.
D for?
Data.
And P for?
Physical.
Physical. So guys, these are some of the like layers which we have, right? Application, presentation, session, transport, network, data link layer, and physical layer. Obviously, we can place like layer after every single comp, like network layer, transport layer, session layer. So let us remove it from here, otherwise it will create some confusion, right? So there are different layers. So the particular network load balancer works at this particular moment, at this particular session, at this particular layer, right? That is transport layer. Now application load balancer works at this layer. And what is the number of this layer?
L7.
Yes, because we have to count the layers from here. Layer 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Although network comes in between, whether you count from here to here or from here to here, because it is lying in between, but we have to count that that physical layer is the very first layer of TCP IP suite, right? Are we clear with this?
Yes.
Okay, great. So guys, first of all, we need to understand that why do we use application load balancer here? So application load balancer works on layer 7 of TCP IP suite. Guys, you are not going to explain that much to interviewer, right? But for your own understanding, if the person starts deep diving into your answers, then you should have a like answer for it, right? Okay, so first of all, we have application load balancer. Why do we use it? The particular features of application load balancer, I'm going to tell you right away because we do not want to have any sort of confusion. So guys, first of all, the particular application load balancer is responsible to provide, first of all, HTTP/HTTPS based routing. base load balancing rather than calling routing. So this can be used. This is especially used for HTTP and HTTPS. Works on layer 7. Works on layer 7. And which is layer 7? Application. Right? Host and host and path-based routing can be done here, right? These are the basic features of application load balancer. Like basically it is used for HTTP and HTTPS. Now, the counter question can here be, can we use like this particular network load balancer? Can we use network load balancer for routing HTTP or HTTPS traffic? Yes, guys, can we use network load balancer to route HTTP and HTTPS traffic? Yes, Manoj.
I believe like it will work, but more features under ALB, like layer 7. I'm struggling. Okay. So it works, I guess. Like even if it is routing to web server to app server, when we are using network load balancer, then it's supposed to work under application load balancer.
So Manoj, you are right. We can use, but you committed only one mistake when you said I guess. Yeah. So when we are facing interview, there is no scope of guessing things. Okay. That may be or may not be.
Okay.
We have to be specific, either yes or no. Or if you really do not have any idea about it, just say that I do not know.
Okay.
Because if you start guessing the things, and that becomes a habit, that gets into practice. And when you start practicing about anything, that becomes a habit. So we need not to use I guess, I hope. No. These sort of things should not be used during interview, because an interviewer captures every single word, whatever you are saying. Although the answer which you gave was right, but when you said I guess, it means you are hitting a clue. That was not right. The answer was correct, but the way of responding was not right.
Okay.
So guys, network load balancer can also be used for routing HTTP and HTTPS type of request, but now that's the answer, that we do not have the features available. For example, we cannot have host-based routing, path-based routing here. Let us say if we have to filter out the particular traffic based on source IP address, based on an individual API-based routing, right? That sort of thing we cannot have with network load balancer. Network load balancer can be used to forward TCP and UDP type of traffic from a source to destination, without checking these sort of thing, like whether it is for HTTP, HTTPS, like what is host, what is path. No, nothing. You cannot do anything there. But network load balancer will definitely provide you less, like lower latency and high throughput. Network load balancer will provide you lower latency and high throughput. Right, guys? But we do not have these sort of features here. One more thing. So how do I secure network load balancer? Yes, guys. How do I secure network load balancer?
It could be like subnet.
No. Okay, let me change the question. Can I associate a security group with network load balancer? Manish?
Yes, we can. We have a security group in load balancer.
Okay, great. Ankita?
I think that is the web application firewall.
That is a different thing. WAF is different concept. Ankita?
We cannot assign security group to network load balancer.
Yes, we can assign.
We can or we cannot?
We can assign network.
Ankita?
We can assign.
Ankita, my specific question to you is, can we assign a security group to a load balancer, network load balancer or not?
No, we cannot.
Yes, you are right. So guys, the basic difference between these two load balancer, first of all, we cannot assign, remember this particular word, we cannot assign a security group to to network load balancer. Keep this thing in mind. We can assign security group with Elastic Load Balancer, which is especially in app, like application load balancer. Okay, let us remove E from here and let us work with app. Now, because now we have two load balancers. So for distinguishing between both, let's have app ELB and we have like NLB, right? So this is app ELB, this is network load balancer. So guys, we cannot assign a security group with network load balancer. Now the question comes that how do you secure infrastructure? So every single port which we want to open, that will be handled on these individual EC2 machines. Getting point? These EC2 machines will open its port only for a specific IP addresses. Because network load balancer does not provide any security based on security group. Yes, if you want your traffic to be secure, then definitely, guys, you can associate SSL certificate on the top of it. SSL certificate you can associate, but you cannot place a security group with network load balancer. Are we clear with this?
Yes.
Okay, great. Fine. So now the final thing which we have here is that is going to be database. Like within our infrastructure, we will have some databases here. We have some database. It could be any type of database. It could be MySQL, Postgres, master slave architecture and all. So that sort of thing we have. So now guys, how do you manage your databases? So although being DevOps, we are not responsible to manage database all the times. Being DevOps, we are actually not supposed to handle database, because if we are working with any standard organization or any big organization, then database team is always separated. But if there is an organization where only you are the person or you are working with a startup sort of stuff, then being DevOps, you will have to handle database as well. So how do we handle that? Let us have a look of that particular thing as well. So guys, let us talk about MySQL. This is my master. This is my master database. Now, I might have two slaves for this database. This is my slave MySQL. And once more, I have one more database, which is once again a slave for me. Right? I have one master and two slaves. Now these applications are supposed to connect with this database. So guys, how would you ensure that? Okay, how do you place load balancing on the top of this? Is there any mechanism? Is there any way out that you can send read request to these servers and write request to this server? Yes, guys. Are you getting my question? Guys, waiting for your answer.
Like it is like communicating to database. So if it is under private subnet, so we have to open a...
Yes, we have to do what?
Port level, NACL. Enable a port of MySQL to communicate.
Okay, great. Now let me come on to it. So guys, once again, we will have a particular component which is known as proxy server. There is a particular software known as proxy SQL. We will deploy this service at least on two instances. Why it is so? Because if one proxy SQL goes down, then another one should be available. These proxy SQL should be connected to these particular databases, right? These two proxy SQLs are going to work on the top of this MySQL server. Now, we will have a particular network load balancer on the top of these. How it is going to work? These application servers will query to this network load balancer for database. Now this network load balancer will forward request to these proxy SQL servers, and proxy SQL servers will determine whether that is a select query. If that is select query, that will be forwarded to these servers. These like these are slave, and if it is write query, the query will be forwarded to this MySQL server. This is master, as you can read it here, MySQL master database it is. So proxy SQL server will be used to determine whether it is a read or write query. If it is write, or you can consider if it is anything other than select, it will be forwarded to master. Let us say it is alter, delete, truncate, insert, update, any sort of query. If it is, it will be forwarded to master, else it will be forwarded to slave servers. Because slave servers are only used for read-only queries. Are we clear with this thing, guys? And why we are using here network load balancer? Because we are not working with TCP, or like we are not working here with HTTP or HTTPS request. Right, guys?
Yeah.
So now it's your time. Do you have any question?
So instead of proxy server, can we give a network gateway like a...
Come again?
Instead of like a proxy server, like I'm not aware of. So a proxy server, instead of proxy server, can we give network gateway there? And
no.
Give a routing table?
No, never. Why it is so? Because see, proxy SQL is determining the rules. Whether, let us say, the application wants to update anything into database, so this particular proxy server will determine whether the query or the request which is coming from this particular application server is update, insert, alter, delete, or whatever query it is. If it is select, it will forward to slave. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it will forward to master. Because proxy SQL server has the capabilities to determine the type of query. Where you know application gateway, your network gateway, these gateways do not have capabilities to determine the type of query.
Okay.
That's so why when, proxy SQL is the option here.
Okay. When it comes to the VPC, so it comes to the whole VPC under in one VPC, like there would be a public subnet and the private subnet. So these sort of things will not come under this.
Okay. Come again. What did you say?
Like in one VPC, so it would be a private subnet and a public subnet, right? So I'm confused there. Like, okay, this will come under one VPC.
Okay. So, okay. First of all, let me ask you a question. Are we clear so far?
Yes, sir. I'm clear with it.
Whatever things we have discussed so far, are we clear with it? So when we are talking about this particular component, this is known as infrastructure architecture. So I hope that we are clear so far with this, right?
Yes, sir, we are clear.
Okay, so let me remove it. And now what I'm going to do here is I am going to explain about the other components of the infrastructure. So let me drop this thing here. Just allow me to have a moment. That we should be knowing that what we have been doing here. So we have been discussing that how do we resolve a particular request from here to here, right? So yes, that is it. And we were talking about that laptop as well. Let us bring that laptop in. So we have that laptop here. Okay. Yes, here we are. Okay, fine. So guys, when we are talking about this particular thing, so I hope that as you guys are saying that you are clear with it, so let us not spend more time here. Let us talk something else. So the particular VPC section, the query which you have right now, so we are going to discuss about that particular component, right? So guys, when we design a VPC, we have to take care of two things. That what are the requirements actually, right? So in order to design a VPC, we need to take care of a couple of things here. First of all, there are three types of applications we have. I'm going to give you like 10,000 feet overview today, but definitely we will be discussing these particular things in detail in coming sessions, right? Okay. So for now, you can understand that first of all, we have a particular VPC here. We have a particular one. This is complete one VPC. This is like web server subnet, right? Then after we might have another component which is known as app server. Finally, we might have database. DB servers we might have here, right? Okay. So now when we are talking about that, how do we need to like figure out that how we are going to secure this and what is going to be the things on the top of it? So guys, we have these three subnets, right? So let me define subnet here. These are going to be some different type of subnets here, right? Now, on the top of these subnets, we will have some route tables. We will have route tables here, right? On the top of it, we will have some different route table. On the top of it, we might have some different route table, right? Just do let me know if you have any query here. Right, guys? Okay, so we will have different route tables here. Like this is going to be for web server, this is going to be for app server, and this is going to be for any other. Now, on the top of this route table, how we are going to ensure that this will accept traffic from internet? So we will have some gateways. We will have internet gateway here. We will have internet gateway on the top of this route table. Right, guys? Then after, we will have another gateway, which is going to be NAT gateway. NAT gateway will be placed on the top of this. Right? And finally, we will not have any gateway associated here with database server, but yes, if it is required, we can place NAT gateway on the top of it on demand. For example, we need to download something on database servers, right? If we need to download anything on the top of these servers, we need to download updates from internet, then we might associate this route table behind NAT gateway only. Right, guys? Are we clear with this, guys?
Yes, yes, clear.
So now one more thing we can have. So either we can have separate route tables within same VPC, or within coming session we are going to, when we will be discussing about VPC completely, so we will get to know that either we can have separate route tables here, or we can create separate VPCs for separate services. But in that case, definitely network cost will definitely increase a little. Right, guys? So this is our VPC. So yes, guys, this is the particular diagram which we are going to discuss. Like this is DNS, application load balancer, target group for web servers, network load balancer, like target group for application server, proxy SQL, network load balancer. We have these services, and this is that is it. Now, guys, there will be a question if someone is really interested to know about application load balancer. So let us say if we define here HTTPS. https://www.serveryan.com. If someone is going to type in like this, so there will be another question that where do you terminate SSL connections? Like terminating means like where would you place SSL certificate? Yes, guys.
Under load balancer, application load balancer.
We have to associate SSL to our DNS.
Okay. Stalin, what do you say?
No idea.
Ankita?
DNS?
No. Okay, let me tell you that. So guys, we need to have SSL termination enabled on the top of application load balancer. Why it is so? Let us say we have these servers, right? We have these 9 servers, and there will be a point in time where we might have like 200 servers. And SSL certificate is going to go for expiry now, right? So in that case, we will have to update our SSL certificate on the top of 200 web servers, which will be once again a tedious task to perform. Wherein, if we need to replace SSL certificate on the top of this application load balancer, although we can have, let us say we are using AWS. So AWS provides its own service, which is known as ACM, like Amazon Certificate Manager. So that can auto renew your certificates, which are associated with your servers, first thing. Second thing here is, it is not necessary that you are going to have certificate placed on all the servers. You can have certificate on ELB, and application load balancer is going to auto renew the certificate for your requirement. So the answer here is that we terminate SSL certificate on the top of these web servers. Now the person might ask you that, how do you ensure that your servers are secure? So you can say that we have self-signed certificate placed here on this particular target group servers, and whatever, like we accept traffic from public on HTTP and HTTPS both. Whenever traffic is coming to our load balancer, we redirect all the traffic coming on port 80 to port 443, like HTTP request is redirected to HTTPS on the top of load balancer on. Right, guys? So guys, I guess that is it for today. Now it's your time to ask any question or to share any feedback if you have.
So when you say like HTTPS, so the port number is 443, correct?
Right.
And for HTTP, port number 80, correct?
Correct.
So some sort of I saw some are using port 8443.
That is custom port.
custom
like port. you can use any port for HTTPS. For example, you have only one server where HTTPS port is already in use, but let us say you want to have multiple domains running on different port.
Okay.
So in that case, you can use any number of port, because we have like 36 port numbers.
Mm-hmm.
So you can use any port for HTTP for HTTPS. Maybe in fact, like you can use port number 81 for SSL. That does not like restrict you. So you can use any port for HTTPS.
Okay.
Maybe you can use port number 8080 for HTTP.
Mm-hmm.
So you can use any port. You are not restricted to use any port for any specific protocol, right? But yes, the particular standard ports, which are, let us say, port number 88 for reserve for anything, port 81 for reserve for any other thing, let us say port 25 for any other like protocol, right? So except standard ports, which are registered and which are well-known ports, you can acquire any port to run your HTTPS or HTTP service. You are open to do that. You are free to do so.
Okay.
Yes. So, okay, guys, now once again, I would ask for the feedback for the session if you have any.
No, it was awesome. Thanks, Lokendra. So I got a really good point on this.
Great. Good to know that. Ankita?
Yes, it was good.
Okay. Any other one would like to share feedback?
Yes, it was really nice.
So it means, are we covering the same thing which are usually discussed during interview?
Yes, I got a clarity on ELB and NLB. So they majorly they ask these questions. So I got really stuck there. Now I got clear picture on this.
And Stalin, any word from your side?
I never started an interview right now. Maybe yes. Right now, yes, it's a good session.
Great. So if you follow the same thing, if you try to understand the depth of the topics which we are discussing, and for sure, guys, as I told you that we are focusing on the interview perspective only. So I must not be saying that I'll cover 100%. Whatever interviewer is going to ask, I'll be teaching each and everything. But yes, guys, if you answer these many things even, then the good enough chances of getting jobs are there. So, well, thank you, everyone. Thank you so very much for your time. Now we will see on Monday, because tomorrow I'll be traveling. So we will see on Monday.
So can-